60 Minutes with Angela starts right now.
Why should I be the one you target? And other cases are there. So why are you coming after me? So this money, did they declare it? The money was not even supposed to be in her name. It's an illicit money. Hidden, stashed away. It's a proceed of crime. It's concealed. It wasn't meant to be tied to Patience Jonathan. While she's using the money. It's like you acquire property in another person's name. While you are the owner of the property.
Well, hello and welcome. This is 60 Minutes with me, Angela Ajitumobi. Thank you for joining me on the program today. And so here in Nigeria, former First Lady, wife of a former President of the Federal Republic, Patience Jonathan, a retired Permanent Secretary from Ministry of Education in Bayelsa State, that's in the southern zone of the country, filed a suit at the Federal High Court in Lagos against a Nigerian bank called Sky Bank and Nigeria's Economic and Financial Crimes Commission, EFCC. She was seeking to compel the removal of a freeze order on accounts within 14 days. That ultimatum expired on 18th of September, 2016. It's a move many have described as unprecedented, as it exposes how the former First Lady, Patience Jonathan, solely ran accounts which contained huge sums of money in dollars without the said accounts bearing her name or her bank verification number, which we locally call here BVN. How can that be possible, many are asking? How can you have access to a bank account whose BVN you don't own? Did the bank go outside operational guidelines or bend over backwards just because she was the wife of the president at the time? In any case, how does she intend to prove ownership of that money? Does she need to show how she got that money to be able to own it? Join me after the break. I'm counting down 60 minutes with legal practitioner JITI OGUNYE. Welcome back. Welcome, Mr. Ogunye, to 60 Minutes with Angela. Always a pleasure to have you here.
Thanks for inviting me.
Right. Let's start from the beginning. Let's establish some facts as we know them about this case. In my introduction, I talked about how the former First Lady had sued Sky Bank and the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission, claiming ownership of a large sum of money. But tell us the details that you know.
Well, the details that are available in the public domain,
yes.
And again, we must thank the FCC for being generous with the information. And I just, as a preliminary issue, wish to deal with this before I go to your substantive question.
Why do you say you are thanking them for releasing details?
There's been this contention and argument that the EFCC and other anti-corruption agencies are usually engaged in what people call now media trial. My riposte to that argument is that for a long time in this country,
yes,
the Nigerian civil society and the media, everybody, that wanted government to give information to Nigerians without holding information,
yes,
since information is power and knowledge and indeed impacts on how people respond to a number of issues in society, fought for the passage of the FOI bill.
Freedom of Information.
Information bill.
Yes.
And eventually we had the Freedom of Information Act. And so I say that Nigerians deserve to know what is going on in the government, what is going on in the public domain in this country, what public officials do and what they don't do,
yes,
in a transparent manner. And that too often we mouth this cliche of transparency,
yes,
and accountability and probity without actually living it. So when you then see an anti-corruption agency that has no power to convict a criminal defendant, alleged criminal defendant, coming out with information on this is the case we have against this person, it behoves that person, if he believes that he's been defamed, to sue that anti-corruption agency,
okay,
and receive huge sums in damages for defamation of character. But what we see is that in virtually all the cases, we've not seen these persons who allege media persecution and media trial doing that. But we've seen sidekicks, their sympathizers, coming out to say that, oh, you ought not to have given that information. If you have a case, charge it to court. And it is in that context, I say that, as in other cases, what the FCC has done, in being generous, information to give the public is commendable.
Before you go into the meat of the story, as an aside, what then do you say to those who say bringing out all the details into the public domain has brought the former First Lady into public ridicule, has embarrassed her, has humiliated her, and it is tantamount to harassment?
They are the ones harassing Nigerians. What was the harassment here? That an anti-corruption agency is established by law in the discharge of its statutory powers,
yes,
including the power to enlighten Nigerians and educate Nigerians on the evil of corruption, going to churches, going to mosques, going to schools, and all that,
yes,
you know, to enlighten us about the cancerous effect of corruption. That body came out to say, this is the case we have against this person. So that if that body were to move against her, Nigeria will not have any illusion that she is being persecuted on account of her husband being the former president. Don't forget, keep in view the fact that before now, there had been an allegation,
yes,
that former president was associated with those who are doing bombings in the Niger Delta, which he came out to deny. So if in quick succession, you then have the wife being dragged by the FCC without the FCC giving information on the reason why they are investigating her, what will many Nigerians conclude, particularly the sympathizers of such persons? So those who are complaining can complain. Rather, they should commend the FCC for giving information,
yes,
and for making Nigerians know the reason why they feel that she has a case to answer. So in my view, I don't think that she's being harassed. I don't think that she's being humiliated. I don't think that she's been publicly defamed or disgraced. So the jury is still out. She's gone to court now, and we'll get to that. So we'll see how it all ends.
So for the sake of viewers watching now, especially those who are not Nigerians or live in Nigeria with us, what can we ascertain are the facts that we know about this case?
The facts that that are available in the public domain about,
yes,
this case is that some accounts, about four or so,
yes,
were opened in the name of certain companies, real estate company, etc.,
yes,
in Skybank. And that the signatories to these accounts were some of the domestic help and employees of the First Lady in a domestic setting. And that the former First Lady, Dame Patience Jonathan, was not a signatory to this account. But in spite of that, she was now given the platinum card to withdraw money periodically from this I can't.
Okay, just give me a moment. Let me read out the names of those four companies to the viewers. The four companies were Pluto Property and Investment Company Limited, Seagate Property Development and Investment Company Limited, Transocean Property and Investment Company Limited, and Globus Integrated Service Limited. Those were the four companies.
Exactly, those were the four companies. And that, in spite of the fact that he was not on record a signatory to that account, he was given a platinum card to withdraw money from that.
Was she a director of any of the companies?
Not on the face of it. And so, those are the facts that we know.
Yes.
And upon EFCC conducting investigation and realizing that he was part of the whole process of keeping the money there, indeed, she was responsible for that, and that she was the beneficiary of the proceeds of that account,
yes.
The EFCC filed charges against the company. And some of the officials of the companies, you know, have pleaded guilty to the charges in the High Court. Okay. Now, what is interesting to note is that former First Lady has come out to say that this money belonged to her.
Did the EFCC include her name in the charges they brought against the four companies?
I don't think so. Not on the basis of the facts that available. DS could still amend the charge and include a name, you know, as one of the criminal defendants. Maybe for reasons of investigative and prosecutorial discretion, the FCC felt at the time that they did that they needed not to include her name. But I think that there could be other considerations moving forward, particularly when the former First Lady has come out. Not only to institute an action against the FCC, but the bank claiming that the money belonged to her and that she has a right to own movable and immovable property, and that her immovable property, in this case, the money in those accounts, ought not to be seized. In other words, she's alleging a breach of her fundamental right to own movable and immovable property, in this case, the money. And so now that she's done that, I think that the EFCC has every reason, we're not talking about the power now, every reason, now that it has been frontally challenged, to now move further and say, okay, since you claim that you are the owner of this money, come forward and let's see how you're the owner of the money. So that if there is a valid basis to proceed against her, the EFCC can then consider that possibility. I will address that issue further, though, by saying that a lot of Nigerians have joined issue with the EFCC. They are impatient and they want Madam Patience to be brought before the EFCC to answer some questions. They are alleging that she's been given undeserved, decent treatment. Mm. That if she were to be
an ordinary citizen,
she would have been brought and all that. And that may well be so. But, you know, EFCC does not operate in a vacuum. EFCC operates in a political environment.
So can we divorce politics from this?
We can, but in the course of EFCC discharging its mandate, I will imagine that EFCC does not bury its head in the sand like an ostrich. It looks around to make a pre-arrest detention charge prosecution determination of what the consequences and the implication of what it wants to do will be in the polity. So that if there were other steps that could be taken to achieve the same result without unwittingly giving the impression that it is persecuting rather than prosecuting, it would then consider, you know, embarking on those course of action. I'm not saying it as a matter of certainty or certitude that I knew that that's why they've not invited her or arrested her and all that. But if the issue here is the money identified in some bank accounts, traced, frozen, and the companies, the rogue companies that have been used to launder this money have been identified, the bank officials that had been complicit in trying to have the money laundered and conceal the process of crime have been identified by names and all that.
Yes.
And they have no, you know, plausible excuse for what they've done. If all these facts are known and they're there, And ESCs can have that money frozen, not only that, forfeited by legal processes without even subjecting
the former first lady
to any form of detention and all that and all that. And that can still be achieved, the objective being to disgorge this woman of that money.
Yes.
So why would EFCC, in the circumstances, in the prevailing circumstances of what is going on in politics, not be sensitive to the implications of effecting? I'm generating a scenario. Yes. I'm not saying that I know for certain that that's why they've not moved.
And I just wanted you to rehash that. You know, in other words, what you're saying is that if the aim then is the seizure, the forfeiture of that money deemed to be legally acquired, if that's the aim, it can still be achieved without necessarily arresting, prosecuting, or taking the former first lady to court, given the sensitive environment and the sensitive times in which we live.
Exactly. More so when the person who was holding the lever of power, being the husband, as we speak, has not been invited by the EFCC or any other anti-corruption agencies to answer to some questions. So what impression are you going to convey or create? Won't it be alleged that you're leaving a husband?
Yes. Who was the servant?
To then go after the wife needlessly. So all these considerations are there. And so Nigerians deserve justice. They have the right to crusade for justice and to insist that there must be equality of all before the law. People must be treated equally. No sacred cows.
Yes.
Those are the ideals. Perfect. But I'm saying that in the mind of an agency, and this is not about being televided, there are certain considerations that are weighed and weighted carefully before a certain course of action is embarked upon. That is not to say that the spouse of a former president could not be proceeded against. Gbagbo's wife and the husband, you know, have been processed through.
But it's never happened in our country.
Well, yes, it's true.
And I thought wives were always off limits when talking about these kinds of events, especially in politics. I've never seen any executive's wife, be it a governor, a former governor, president or former president's wife, targeted in terms of any investigations.
Well, that may well be so, but generally our law has also been weak in enforcement, even against husbands that were actually in power.
Yes.
So if our law has been weak to that extent, how then do we expect that same law to be so effective against spouses or family members of those who are actually in a position of perpetrating those offenses on a larger scale than their spouses and all that? I think that that's the issue. So, but when we take it that the law, if it starts functioning properly, it then becomes possible without succumbing to the blackmail that one is going after, you know, spouses of those who are in power as an underhand move to humiliate that person who was exercising power.
Yes.
Without succumbing to that blackmail, it becomes possible to do that openly and on grounds of principles that, you know, we have a reason to do this, and nobody can then accuse those agencies of trying to do what has not been done before. Mm. So in that context, it will become very justifiable in the circumstances, and that's what we hope to see. Our society is too tolerant of all the bad things, and for other societies that are not so tolerant, we can see that they are reaping those dividends bountifully. You know, so it's not just in our politics, it cuts across. You see the law lying prostrate, supine in the face of impunity, in the face of defiant transgression of the law, and the law will be so impotent and it will not be able to do anything. And so in a way, that is also responsible in part to the audacity we've seen in this regard. Elsewhere, somebody talked about audacity of hope, and I'm referencing Obama. This, for me, an audacity of impunity. And this is not the first time it's happened. Just for me to reference that quickly, when Mr. Taffa Balogun was arraigned by the FCC and was being subjected to trial, I could remember this vividly. Part of the argument of Tafa Balogun's lawyers, principally Mr. Abayomi, who was one of the contestants in Ondo State,
Tunji
Abayomi, you know, was that Tafa Balogun didn't steal any money. The police wasn't complaining that he had lost any money. So the 17.7 billion naira property was his, because nobody was complaining that it had stolen
nobody
money.
Nobody said its money was missing.
Missing. So if a police chief used his position to start collecting returns and then built a huge war chest from the banks and corporate organizations that need police services, so he's now privatized the police force and is now collecting money, and then he's sending his boys on the road to go and be harassing Nigerians, and then they make returns, and that returns, you know, outflow go up to the zenith of the police force, and is able to build an illicit fortune through that process. And he's been asked question. So the lawyers of that person can indeed come out to say, how dare you ask me any question? I didn't steal your money. And even if I stole it, I wasn't the only one that stole the money. Keep in view that recently, through a year ago, came out to say that I kept 90 million naira in my house and it was stolen. Former first lady. The question is, that 90 million, where did it come from? Why couldn't you keep the money in the bank? And the police in Katsina, yes, were now saying that they were investigating the person. And indeed, the commissioner of police of that state, you know, addressed the president and said that, yes, they've arrested the person. You know, he did it and all that. Police.
Is that the issue, that somebody stole it? What about the other facts?
Exactly. So, this is whom we've become. This is who we are right now. Yeah. And so in that context, a first lady can then say, oh, $50 million. And you are attacking me. In my own part of the country, there was an oil block that was given to a man who represented that he had the capacity, local capacity, his company, to start drilling oil because of local indigenous participation. And he was given an oil block and he sold it for $550 million without lifting a finger. And that man then complained that, oh, I'm awashed with the money. And the problem I have now is that I don't know how to spend it. And even our banks are too fledgling. They are too insecure. They are too weak to even receive this kind of money. So I think that I'm going to take it overseas to keep it somewhere. So it is a country where elite theft of our common patrimony is rife and pervasive. And so within that context, when you see a member of the elite being challenged, he looks at the challenger and says, why me? In fact, he sees it as persecution because of that pervasive impunity. So this is a kind of psychoanalysis. It may not just be a kind of braggadocio or whatever, that for somebody to believe that I have an entitlement for this and that I ought not to be questioned at all.
Yes.
And that this money is even insignificant anyway, considered all that has been stolen in the land. So why are you persecuting me? It's sad. But that's how low we've sunken.
Join us again after the break.
Nice question.
Angela, that's a great question.
It's a good question.
It is difficult to respond to that question.
That is a serious question.
Angela, that is a very great question.
Great question, Angela.
You know, Angela, that's a very difficult question.
That's a great question, Angela.
Okay, that's a great question.
Angela, that's a tough one for me.
That's a good question. Good question.
I love to ask questions. I think it's what I do best. You see, I think that the fastest way to learn anything is to ask questions. The right questions. Questions that help you get to the heart of the matter.
60 Minutes with Angela. Again, answers to every question you always wanted to ask.
Welcome back. If you've just joined us, it's 60 Minutes with me, Angela Ajetunmobi, on my hot seat today. JITI OGUNYE, legal practitioner. Let me just read a quote to you from the letter allegedly written by the former First Lady's lawyer to the EFCC. Quote, our client has been operating the said accounts without any let or hindrance and was therefore surprised when the said cards stopped functioning on July 7, 2016 or thereabout. End of quote. Should these cards have worked at all? Considering the statement that when they were brought, she noticed that the accounts had nothing to do with her, the names on the accounts had nothing to do with her. You know, if they bring an account to you, Mr. Ogunye, you see that this is not Mr. Ogunye or Mr. Ogunye & Co. You complain to the bank to change it. At that stage, what are you supposed to do? Are you supposed to abandon the cards to the bank, refuse to use the cards? Or are you committing an offense by going ahead to continue to use the cards, knowing fully well that your photograph or your bank verification number is not on that account?
You know, this story about her discovering, from what we know, is a cock and bull story. We've lost shame in this country. Infamy has become right, and sleaze has become culture. This is a case of gross indecency, that you could even come forward to start giving this rationalization, as genuine as they are, and explanations. Elsewhere, lawyers would advise, because everybody is entitled to the services of a lawyer of his or her own choice, lawyers would advise this kind of line of defense is not what we need to do. Let's start talking about plea bargaining.
Yes.
This money is going to be forfeited, and we can then say we should not be charged.
But you see,
but you know, blustering has become part of our legal system. You see lawyers taking up a patently frivolous and vexatious action, and driving it through the entire gamut of the judiciary up to the apex level.
Mr. Ogunye, the reason claiming that
they are developing the rule of law. They are not developing the rule
the body of law.
They are just developing the size of their pockets. And you that's know, sad.
Yes.
You know,
some people would disagree with you, myself included, and I'll tell you why. Those who say the audacity of coming out to claim that money miss an essential point, and perhaps this point goes to the impunity that you talk about as well. Mm-hmm. Are we all saying we don't know that people who go to the presidential villa to visit the president, are we saying we don't know they give the first lady gratis?
Look.
These are gifts. We call them dash.
Look,
here.
Look.
Is she going to be blamed for the dash if a former petroleum minister or former finance minister, the president's daughter was getting married and they go to the villa to visit the president and say, ah, madam, well done, you know, getting ready for this. Just manage this small something towards the wedding. These are the things that are done. So when the woman says, it's my money, there is no evidence that she got it from contracts. She did a contract, she didn't perform. If the monies were the result of dashes, she's supposed to give it up.
You know, there are layers and layers of corrupt practices. And then we do not even pay attention to all of them, because the more obvious ones, we've not even sufficiently attended to them. Now, a number of questions. The contention here is that the money belongs to the former first lady. So why did she so desperately try to conceal that money? The money that legitimately belonged to you, you ought not to have created a situation in which that money was now held by some other persons, while you is the one running the account by withdrawing money from the account.
Yeah, yeah.
To the knowledge of your bankers, who are supposed to know their customer by their code of practice.
Yes.
But who played along when they knew that that money was not kept in the bank in your name?
If they played along,
against,
why did they then freeze it?
Ethics of the banks and against the laws, that you concealing money and that you putting money in the name of a person who is not the owner of the money, to your knowledge, and that you delivered the key to that vault, literally speaking, now to a person other than the person who is your customer on your paper. So why did that happen? Second, this whole idea of saying people bring gifts.
Dash.
And I've just given the example of former Dababa, when the allegation was made, when the lawyers were saying that no, you didn't steal any money from anywhere. So that same argument can be used there.
Yes.
That, well, the first lady didn't run any account, wasn't a signatory to any account, he didn't occupy any government other than being first lady who had an office. So come and tell us that she stole this money. She didn't steal this money. This money belonged to her. Now, under the code of conduct, it is not only the person who is occupying the office.
That is the president, or that's the former president.
Yes. Why would anybody want to give her that dash? In respect of what? She was the first lady, right? So what was that money meant for? Is it possible at all that she was a trustee of that money in favor of the husband? Those are the issues. Because you see, yes, you want to corrupt somebody and then you find a proxy or an ally to give the money to, so that the money will not be given to the person who is going to do that favor. That's corrupt practices. So it is not as simple as they want people to believe. The only thing here is that we've trivialized corrupt practices to such an extent that things that ought to make us very angry,
yes,
no longer make us angry now, because the bigger ones are there.
Yes. And just and like we this haven't one, solved we anyone.
Exactly. Mm. But that doesn't mean that, you know, as far as the law is concerned, that those acts were permissible acts. So it's permissible for the child of a president to be running a kind of receptacle to take in money from contractors, from politicians who want to be given nominations in primaries, from all sorts of people, you know, using position of power,
yes,
and authority to amass wealth. That's unlawful.
If Patience Jonathan were your client, would you have advised her to come out and claim ownership of that money? Or would you say, distance yourself from this, cut your losses and move on?
No. If she's insistent on telling the truth, I will advise her to say so. That if this money was not from directly from government coffer,
yes,
you come out and say, look, this, I didn't take this money from government. The truth of the matter is that by virtue of my position and association with my husband, I received gifts, I received all these things that you said.
Yes.
And so I believe that the money to that extent belongs to me. However, if I've infracted the law by receiving those gifts, I will want
the music
and forfeit the money.
Okay, you doesn't that raise issues of tax, for instance, declaration of assets? You do know that the former president on leaving office by law is required to declare his assets.
That's why I talked about the code of conduct. So this money, did they declare it? The money was not even supposed to be in her name. It's an illicit money, hidden, stashed away. It's a proceed of crime. I have no hesitation in saying so. It's concealed.
Yes.
It wasn't meant to be tied to her while she's using the money. It's like you acquire property in another person's name while you are the owner of the property.
Then why would she come out to say it's her own if the concealment was done? In coming out, she's removed the cloak of concealment.
Which is why people wonder, what are you then waiting for, EFCC? She's admitted that she's the owner of the money. She's given an open admission, boastful admission. She's accepted it all. So it is cut and dry. It's so obvious. So what do you need to prove further? Although you may still need to prove something for that in the trial situation.
Yes.
So go after her since she's made this admission. But a certain person from the Niger Delta was asked to come before a court. And that person has not come now. And bombing of oil installations resumed. So when Nigeria is fast becoming a state where rogue elements have the audacity to challenge the state. And so by and by, the nibble, I've said this before,
yes,
at the prestige of a state and its capacity to maintain law and order. All over the country, it's the same thing. Policemen get killed, civilians get killed by policemen, kidnappers kidnap people, you know, and demand for ransom. When that happens, the victims of that kidnapping, you know, sometimes come out to say that, yeah, these people, we are not the targets, but they are saying that the country has been ruined by politicians. That's why, you know,
they are kidnapping.
Start making excuses in a way for them. So the state has become very, very weak. And even when the police say, don't pay ransom, they say, why would I pay ransom? You couldn't prevent me from being kidnapped in the first instance. So you are now saying that you don't pay ransom.
Yes.
They pay ransom, they come out, they deny that they pay ransom. So it's a very complicated thing. I can imagine, therefore, that even in spite of that open admission, the EFCC is not in a hurry to then grab her and say that since you've admitted, so let's now take you through the threshing floor of the adjudicatory system.
Join us again after the break.
Nice question.
Angela, that's a great question.
It's a good question.
It is difficult to respond to that question.
That is a serious question.
Angela, that is a very great question.
Great question, Angela.
You know, Angela, that's a very difficult question.
That's a great question, Angela.
Okay, that's a great question.
Angela, that's a tough one for me.
That's a good question. Good question.
I love to ask questions. I think it's what I do best. You see, I think that the fastest way to learn anything is to ask questions. The right questions. Questions that help you get to the heart of the matter.
60 Minutes with Angela. Again, answers to every question you always wanted to ask.
Welcome back. My concluding moments now with JITI Ogunye, legal practitioner and principal partner, JITI Ogunye and Co. Legal Practitioners. Does the EFCC have to arrest her before charging her to court?
Yeah. Under their procedure and under the law, you don't charge somebody to court and expect the person to
just
send her to court and all that. There are procedures. A person allegedly has committed an offense is going to be invited. Statement will be taken from him or her under caution. May be given administrative bail to go home. And on an appointed date, he or she is going to be charged to court. He comes to court based on the court summons.
Mm.
Right. So these are the procedures. And so these are things that cannot be done or effected without that person being brought in. Call it arrest, call it being summoned, call it heeding the invitation of the anti-corruption agency. He or she will be invited to come forward and make certain statements. And if he or she doesn't want to make a statement, as he or she is allowed to do, to refrain from doing under the law, and I'm talking about Section 36 of the Constitution, the right to fair hearing, you have a right not to self-incriminate, and you have a right to remain silent and say you won't volunteer a statement. You can't be compelled to do that.
Do we have that right in Nigeria? What they call the Miranda right?
Miranda right. It's embedded.
We have it here.
We have it. It's embedded.
I've never heard any policeman use it.
Rather than use it, they club a suspect, break their heads, torture them to extract confessional statement from them, believing that they need that confessional statement, you know, to nail
those secure suspects, a conviction.
Conviction. And sometimes when the suspects give those confessional statements, they then get to court and deny those confessional statements. And then unfold a situation in which during the trial, you then have what we call trial within trial.
Yes.
Trial within trial to determine whether that purported confessional statement was voluntarily made. It's a procedure by which the voluntariness of that confessional statement is determined. But now the Administration of Criminal Justice Act has made a specific provision for that, beautifully, specifically. But before now, it's embedded. The interpretation of our law has made it very clear that a person has a right not to self-condemn or self-incriminate in exercise of his entrenched right to fair hearing.
Okay, so just to be clear, are you saying that it is not lawful for me to be the sole signatory to an account that doesn't bear my name, doesn't bear my photograph, and doesn't bear my bank verification number? Will that be deemed to be illegal, money laundering, or?
It is a criminal offense. It's bordering on forgery and falsification. You know, a banker, before an account, is a laborious process. They ask you, go and bring your means of identification.
Yes.
Go and bring guarantors. Go and bring those who know you, or referee. Then go and bring documents showing that you are the person. Go and bring bills showing that you are living in a particular place. And
do
all
we
that.
Know if those four companies were registered at the Corporate Affairs Commission?
Obviously, they will be registered. I suspect that they will register the company. That, well, what does it take to register a company anyway?
Yes.
So register the company, and then you have this. You then deliver the key, as I said earlier, to a person who is a foreigner to the accounts.
All the details.
All the details. There. So what were you thinking? What were you doing other than blatant commission of crime? But on our side, I think that there was a consensus that when you are committing crime to aid those who are in power, you are covered
by and this immunity.
You are yes, you are covered. Their immunity extends to you and that nothing will happen to you.
So the only reason we're hearing about this now is because power changed nationally.
That exactly. Otherwise, all the banks, if the law were to be enforced so rigidly, many of our bankers would be in jail for being accessory to all the kind of crimes that are committed. Until recently, when people started putting money in their soakaway or whatever in their buildings, people are keeping money in these banks. Indeed, from all that we've learned, the certain person that kept money in the vaults of banks, just in the vaults of the bank, with those money not being documented.
In the bank?
Foreign exchange.
In the bank?
In the bank. So what will make law enforcement agents to go into the vault of the bank and start? And then this will be known to the managing director or manager and all that.
Yes.
In our banks, as we speak.
That also brings me to the point that...
So what are you then going to do?
How do we know that these things are still not going on?
Mind you, from the facts that we know,
yeah,
just as a validation of what I've said, in case anybody may doubt the authenticity of what I'm saying, if our case money was kept in the bank and serially was now being taken and lodged in the bank. In other words, they received that huge sum of money,
yes,
in the bank and kept them. And from there, piecemeal,
they started moving.
Yeah. That's not the function of a bank. That's,
it wasn't documented.
No.
No paper, no account number, nothing.
Nothing. At primaries, at functions, people call bankers and they just bring the money in bullion van and all that. Bankers do all sorts of things, also under pressure, because they have competitors, before they want to meet targets, before they want to also live large,
yeah,
and all that. Because you see, when you help somebody keep illicit money, you also begin to develop interest in some of the proceeds of that illicit money, you know, rubbing off on you.
You feel entitled to something.
Yeah, yes. We are even helping you to keep this kind of money. December is coming. You see, they also see those people as benefactors. Things are hard, madam. So, what can we have? Come, this is my banker.
Yeah.
Because you believe that he's helping you to keep your secret, your dirty secrets. It's something, corrupt practices have multiplier effects. It's not even about ruining the economy or ruining society. It's also ruining people and their morality.
The supporters of the former First Lady talk about breaches of the 99 Constitution and the African Charter on Human Rights. That's 2004. What's that all about?
This is my money. I arrived at the right to own money and immovable property.
Yes.
And so this is my money.
And this seizure is infringing on my human rights.
Fundamental right to own property.
Right.
So you go to court and then start talking about,
okay,
breach of
the So the threat to go to the African Commission on Human Rights at the Gambia, should the EFCC be scared? Should we be worried about that threat?
No, not at all. It's just a stunt. They're not going to any African Commission and all that. In,
yes,
any case, the provision of the African Charter,
yes,
are enforceable in Nigeria in our courts under the Fundamental Rights Enforcement Procedure. The two principal provisions that are enforceable,
yes,
under that procedure are Chapter 4 of the Constitution, listing and enumerating
all
the fundamental
rights
in Nigeria,
mm,
and the provisions of the African Charter. So the issue of going to the African Commission should just be dismissed. It's like it happens often in this jurisdiction. Anytime there's a political, people say that they want to go to the Hague, they want to go to UN, they want to defy the petition, mm, and all that.
Mm.
A local jurisdiction is sufficient,
yes,
to deal with alleged cases of breach of fundamental rights, assuming that this indeed is one such case of breach, mm, of fundamental rights. But the court will decide that,
yes,
and then we'll see how it goes.
And they've also talked about some properties, that's physical properties, homes, all over the country, some even in different states of the country, and they're saying that these assets will need to be verified. What does verification entail?
Verification in an investigation process will entail going to the respective land registry,
right,
to determine who is the owner of the property, and then once that is established and this property is traced,
mm,
to a particular person,
yes,
the person can then be called upon to come and give information about how he or she acquires this property. In this case, the First Lady will be called upon to then tell Nigerians, tell the commission how she came about this property, if indeed she's the owner of this property. And I can understand why a first lady would say, why are you coming after me, the former first ladies? Have you investigated
all of them?
Former presidents, including, you know, the president who was mobilizing Nigerians to build a library for him,
yes,
and all that, hotel and all that, while he was still in power. Have you gone after him? That's why I've said earlier, and that's why I use the word carefully, psychoanalysis, that yes, there may be a feeling that if you're persecuting me, this,
why am I the soft target?
My entitlement.
Here?
Why am I? Others have been doing it, and I've just done what others did. But you're not proceeding against others, and then you are targeting me. So what's it? After all, we are no longer in power. Mm. You have your own opportunity to make your own money now. It is that bizarre. And so, and what I keep telling people when they say that is that, look, my interest in seeing that somebody who has committed an offense,
yes,
is brought to justice is that thereby a precedent is created. I have argued when people are saying that, oh, certain cases that are going in the country were politically motivated, it was because there was a disagreement, I wanted to be a senior president. And I said, look, my interest in that matter was that if you are successfully prosecuted, it creates a precedent for a governor tomorrow to be prosecuted.
Yes.
For even a president to be sent to jail. Israel has done it. Olmert is in jail right now. A prime minister. So because of my learning and disposition and interest, the very idea that I'm above the law, I'm a sacred cow, this law is not meant to target somebody like me,
yes,
or bring people like me to justice. This law is meant for other people. It affronts my sense of justice and it unsettles me, it even makes me exasperated and angry. So no matter how powerful you are, I derive joy. I'm not a masochist.
Yes.
I derive joy in seeing you, if you've infracted the law, being treated in the same way an ordinary person is being treated. That is the notion of justice that I admire and value, that the law is so strong as to treat unequal people equally. People who are unequal in means, in power, in privileges, in positions, in statuses,
yes,
are treated equally by the law. That is the essence of the rule of law. But I can understand if you have this former first lady saying, oh, why should I be the one you target? And other cases are there. So why are you coming after me? That's how low we sunk in this country.
And finally, the order, the no debit order. The EFCC says that they did go to court before they, you know, froze the account. Will they go to court now to unfreeze it?
No, it's unlikely. They will consolidate that by asking the court to forfeit it. That we've concluded our investigation. This is what it is. The person has said that the owner of the money, not be able to prove, so forfeit it
to the federal
to government. Federal government. And then at that point, the person who claims he's the owner of the money will join issues with the FCC and say, it is my money, you can't forfeit it. And then the court will rule on the matter. Indeed, if I'm permitted to say it, that should have been the correct approach, instead of saying that you are inventing the fundamental rights case, an alleged breach out of it. You've been accused of committing a crime. You go there and say that, no, this is no crime.
Yes.
This is just my fringe benefits.
Fringe benefits.
That I'm entitled to as a first lady. As a first lady, I attract...
Gratis.
I attract benefits. And these are not covered by budget or anything. Mm. So, and I'm entitled to keep the money. Hopefully, that may be a way of establishing a new rule of law.
Mm. It may push the boundaries of the law.
Is exactly. Mm. And then future first lady may thank him for helping developing the law in that negative sense. That now, so we can even keep our money now.
Yes. And gifts that are normally given to the first lady. I thought the gift belonged to the office, but not to the individual.
Yeah. That's, look elsewhere. In the United States, even under our own jurisdiction, those gifts are meant to be disclosed under the code of conduct, except very personal. And it's not monetary gifts like that, like artifacts, things like that.
Paintings
and all that. But when you then have a situation where that humongous amount is kept, and then somebody says that, It's my money. Nigeria is a wonderful place. And we hope that it will not become more wonderful in the wrong direction.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ogunye, for coming back on the program.
It's my pleasure.
And thank you for watching. I'm Angela at JITI OGUNYE.